All right, shall we begin? I think it's about the right time. I want to welcome everyone this morning to our invited lecture this afternoon, or this morning, according to your point of view, who is Professor Simona Della Rocca, Simonki Della Rocca from the University of Torino, now Professor Emeritus, whose work is very, very well known in this community and very influential on me myself. And therefore, for me, it's quite an honor to be in the position to introduce her to you. She's done very much work over many years in the foundations of the lambda calculus. The thing that for me is most memorable and most elegant is the work on intersection type discipline, which has made very deep connections between lambda calculus, proof theory, type inference for programming languages, verification with type refinements, and also connections with mathematics through things like the filter lambda model. It's a distinct honor. I've been following her work since I was a student, and it's a pleasure for me to introduce her today. She will tell you about her recent work on the lambda calculus and for probabilistic computation. Simona, welcome, and we look forward to your lecture.
Thank you, Bob, for your kind introduction. And I would like also to thank the organizer for inviting me. Now I try to share the screen and hoping it works. Share. Okay, it's visible?
Yes.
Yes, okay. So the title of my talk is A Foundational Lambda Calculus for Probabilistic Computation. And this is based on a joint work with Claudia Fagian and Ugo Dall'Aco. So some short introduction. If you want a probabilistic programming language, we need to support in the syntax of the language at least discrete distributions, providing a probabilistic construct, modeling, sampling from a distribution. And so if our aim is to model higher order probabilistic computation, a natural approach is to take the lambda calculus as a paradigmatic language, enriching it with a probabilistic choice operator. This is not a new choice. This choice has been made already by a lot of people working on a probabilistic computation. This kind of choice is in some sense problematic, since the so-obtained calculus has not the confluence property, which is one of the essential property. Sorry?
May I mention that you're not on full screen, that the slides are not on full screen. We're seeing looks like it might be your browser or app.
Strange. I can start from the beginning.
I see the title slide. Maybe it should be full screen or something. Yes, that could be. Yep.
Now it's okay.
No, it's not showing full screen, sorry.
But I have full screen. I have Acrobat Reader with full screen.
Yeah, but it's not working, sorry.
I can stop share and try it again. Is the only procedure I know for this. So let's start again.
It should
share.
Share. Yeah, no, that's okay. Better. That's better. That's good.
That's good, Simona.
That's good. Okay.
Who knows why?
Maybe you have to go back. Unfortunately, sorry. With the slide.
Yes, but I cannot. The problem is that now I cannot move. See? I cannot move my screen. This is strange. I can do again the same procedure. Uffa. So share. It's not working. I cannot move my slides.
No.
I go back, exit full screen.
Try sharing the window and put the PDF as large as possible. So maybe it's a suboptimal solution, but at least we have. So you remove everything from.
Now you can see something.
Yeah, we see, but remove the bookmarks and whatever.
Yes, but I have a very small laptop. This is the problem. I can try another time, and we can see if it works. Oh, and now it works.
Yes, for us it works, but we will not see the full screen. Sorry.
I have the full screen.
But we do not see.
It's strange, since I already did a conference at a workshop, and it was. Bring sharing is pause.
Simona, if you close these bookmarks, things on the left and these other things on the right, maybe you get a larger slide and so.
I have something written, sharing is paused, bring your shared window to the front, but I cannot do anything. Just.
I would suggest put it on full screen in the application and then share that particular window.
I cannot do that. In order to share the screen, I need to do not have a full screen. And to put the full screen after.
Yeah,
so let's try. And now you can see.
No, we cannot see, sorry.
I don't know how to say. Resume share.
Try sharing the screen instead of the application, Simona. What are you sharing? The screen of the application? Because when it offers you to.
I have just one possibility, share screen, not other possibility.
It does not choose something, whiteboard or the name of some application.
No, there is just a share screen and no other possibility.
Okay.
View stream. I can try again. I don't know how to say.
So maybe, because I don't know which kind of. So maybe if when it says share screen, you have to select something in the screen. Maybe yes, not so.
We have just two possibilities. View stream on custom live streaming service, copy streaming link.
No, but this stream is another thing, another stuff.
There are some suggestions on the chat.
Yeah. But otherwise, what?
Too much suggestion. I cannot. I cannot read all the suggestions.
So let's try.
Maybe you can.
Simona, can you open the window, and then in the window you just click on bookmarks on the left, and then you remove the things on the right, and we shall have as a larger slide maybe. If you share when it works.
Yes. I can share now.
Yeah.
And
so if you click on these bookmarks on the left, then you remove these bookmarks on the left.
Okay.
And then you remove this part on the right. On the right, you see this part here. There is something on the right, and there is a triangle on the middle of the screen on the right.
In order to erase this, I don't know.
On the right, there is a triangle on the you're. Now it's not seeing anymore. So there is a triangle in the, there is a bar on the left.
Here?
This is a little triangle, maybe you see it. Okay. Well, let's go this way, Simona. If it's okay for you, we can go this way, I think. But not
it's changing. not really the best, but
sorry, so no, otherwise there is no other solution.
Yes, that is strange since the other time it was worked
as well. You see, so
the important is, can you see the slides?
We perfectly now, sorry.
So let's go. Okay. So let's start from the beginning again. I'm sorry. I was speaking about the choice of modeling probabilistic computation, choosing the lambda calculus as a paradigmatic language, and reaching it with a probabilistic choice operator. As I said before, this is not a new choice. A lot of people working on probability computation choosing this kind of calculus. The problem of this kind of calculus is that it has not the confluence property. And a well-known example is XOR operator between two copies of the same variable, following whose argument is a choice between the two Boolean constant true and false. In this case, if we choose the right radix, this means first we perform the probabilistic choice, obtaining either true or false, I assume with probability 1/2, for example. Then, in both cases, the result will be false. So the result of this computation is false with probability 1. But if we choose the left radix, so we first perform the beta rule, so we duplicate the choice true plus false, then we have now the possibility of performing two different choices in the two different places. And so now the result is either true or false with probability each one 1/2. Since now also the exclusive OR between true and false or false and true will appear. In the literature, this has been handled by fixing a deterministic reduction strategy, typically the leftmost one. But we want to follow a completely different approach, taking seriously the distinction made first by Plotkin between a calculus and a programming language. So a calculus defines the reduction rules and it enjoys confluence and standardization, while a programming language performs the reduction according to a given reduction strategy. And what relates the two is the property of standardization, in the sense that the language implements the standard strategy of the calculus. By definition, the standard strategy is complete with respect to all the evaluation, so no evaluation is lost and all is okay. And this is the connection between, for example, the lambda calculus and the programming language Haskell, or the call by value lambda calculus and the programming language ML. And we want to play the same job for the probabilistic computation. And I will present some result we obtained. We defined a probabilistic lambda calculus lambda plus, enjoying the following properties, confluence and standardization. In the extended way, this means that we take into account the asymptotic behavior of terms and with the property that asymptotic confluence supplies the unicity of the resulting limit computation, and the asymptotic standardization supplies a family of complete reduction strategy which are guaranteed to reach the result. And moreover, in this language, we extend the notion of solvability, which correspond in the lambda calculus to the meaningfulness of programs to a probabilistic setting. And we succeeded in giving a complete characterization of solvability in this language, in this calculus lambda plus, through an intersection type assignment system, which induced also a denotational model. So, in order to start, I needed to introduce an important tool of the language, which is a multi-distribution. A multi-distribution on a countable set is a finite multiset of elements of the set, each one appearing associated with a given probability. And notice that this is a multiset, not a set. So a term can appear more than once in the multiset, maybe with different or equal probability. And we use these multi-distributions denoted by M or N in order to represent syntactically a discrete sub-probability space. While sub-probability, since we ask that the total sum of the probabilities is less or equal than one. There is a clear relationship between a multi-distribution and a distribution, since to every multi-distribution, a probability distribution is associated. So for example, if we have the multi-distribution to which X appear twice each time with the probability 1/2, then the associated multi-distribution is a function giving to X, assigning to X the probability 1. And we represent sometimes the function also in this way. Mu m is x associated with the probability 1. Certainly, the relationship between multi-distribution and distribution is not one-one, since maybe we can have two multi-distribution like this two one, which are different, but they correspond to the same distribution, is the usual relation between a multiset and set. So now the language, we take the lambda calculus with the standard syntax, enriched by a plus operator, which represent the probabilistic choice. So nothing new in this choice. The reduction rules are the usual beta rule, plus two probabilistic rules, choosing either the left or the right element of a probabilistic choice. As usual, the reduction is defined to be the contextual closure of a reduction rule. Here we need to introduce two notions of context. The normal context, which are just the obtained enriching syntax of the language, the calculus, by introducing a new constant, which is the all, that can be filled by an element, by a term, or surface context, in which the all cannot appear in argument position and not also in argument position of a plus operator. And then we define the reduction as the closure under context of the beta rule, but by the closure under surface context of the plus rule. Notice that the rule is a relation between terms, while a reduction is a relation between a term and a multi-distribution. The multi-distribution is, in case of the beta reduction, a singleton with probability one. Sometimes I will not write the probability when the probability is equal to one. While in the case of a plus reduction, the result is a multi-distribution with two elements corresponding to the context filled by the two argument of the plus operator, each one with the probability 1/2. This means that in the calculus, the beta reduction is unrestricted, while the plus reduction is automatically forbidden in the argument of an application and under the operator plus. Now we need to lift the reduction to multi-distribution. So the important rule is this one. If we have a multi-distribution in which each element appear with its probability, we can reduce a subset of this term and result is the union of the multi-distribution obtained by means of this reduction. Notice that the set I can be empty, so the reduction between multi-distribution is reflexive. And for example, if we have the identity term, which is lambda xx, and the term erasing this second argument, k, here we have, if you consider the term lambda x, x I plus k, this reduces to a multi-distribution of two elements in this way, and I applied to k reduce beta to a multi-distribution in which k appear with probability one. When you put together, we put together these two terms, this and that, into a multi-distribution, for example, in this case, each one with probability 1/2. Now the reduction is not deterministic, since we have four choices. Notice that in any case, we have one step reduction. And so we can either reduce the second element here, or reduce the first one, or reduce both, or reduce nothing. And this is the reduction between multi-distribution. So the first property we prove is that the system, the calculus is confluent, and we need to define what is a reduction sequence. Certainly this definition is standard, is a sequence of multi-distribution such that every multiset reduces to the next one in the sequence. And we need to speak here about both finite and unfinite sequences with different notation. M, arrow, star, N denote a finite sequence, while we denote an infinite one in this way. So the reduction is confluent. And the proof is in some sense quite standard, since we use the tools supplied by lambda calculus. We first provide a sound and complete translation from lambda plus to lambda calculus. Then we prove the first separately the confluence of the two reductions, and then their commutation. And finally, we use the Ingley-Rosen lemma, and so we obtain the confluence of all the calculus. In lambda calculus, the confluence property implies as important corollary the unicity of normal form. So the unicity of the result of computation, if we look at a normal form as the result of our computation. This is not so clear in the probabilistic computation, since what is the result of a probabilistic computation in a calculus? In a programming language, the problem is easy. The answer is well known. We take the program, we evaluate the program according to the standard, the chosen strategy, and at the end, when there are no more reduxes to be reducted according to this strategy, we have the result. But here is not so clear. And another question is if the confluence implies the uniqueness of the result, exactly like for lambda calculus. And we need to take into account this important fact that the result of a probabilistic computation is a limit, even if we have a almost a sure termination. This means that the probability that a term leads to normal form is one. Maybe this degree of certitude is not reached in a finite number of steps, but it can appear as a limit of an infinite sequence of computation. For example, take this term n, which is the self-application function plus the identity. If we consider the multi-distribution with the only element n applied to n, we can reduce it to a multi-distribution in which n applied to n appear again with probability 1/2, And now there is with probability one half a term which is equal to the identity, and so on. At every reduction, we can build the sequence in such a way that at every step, a new identity term appears with different probability. The limit of this is the identity with probability one, but this one is obtained as the sum of the infinite series, one half, one fourth, and so on. So we need to speak about infinite computation. So in order to define what is a result and taking seriously what means to have an probabilistic evaluation, we can say that the result of a probabilistic evaluation is a distribution on some events to which we are interested in. And that from a point of, in order to reflect syntactically this definition, we define a set of observation as a subset of the power set of terms of lambda plus, such that for two elements of a set of observation, the intersection is empty. And in particular, the probability of looking for a particular element of our set is not decreasing during the reduction. This is the key property we want for a set of observation. And this is based on another observation made, at least I read it really, by Plotkin when reasoning about Kolbe value, when he said that a value cannot never be transformed into a not value by reducing it. So values must be closed by reduction. And it's natural to extend it to every notion of result. A result must be closed by reduction, cannot be transformed in something which is not a result. Example of a set of observation which have this property is, for example, the set of normal forms. And if we take the same example as before, if you consider this distribution, n is the only element with probability one, the probability of having a normal form here is zero. While here, after one reduction step, the probability of finding a normal form is one half. After another step of reduction, the probability of having a normal form is 3/4. And this probability is, in this case, strictly increasing with the reduction. With this sequence, is strictly increasing. But maybe we are interested not to the event of obtaining a normal form, but the event of reaching a particular normal form as a result. So another, in this case, the set of observation is the set of the singleton of normal forms. For example, if we consider the multi-distribution 1/2 n, n is always the same term, and 1/2 the identity, the probability of finding, now we are asking to find the identity as a result, is 1/2. But we want to observe the probability of finding, of having another normal form, for example, k, in this case, the probability is zero. And this corresponds to two observations with respect to normal form. To observe the event of being a normal form, or to observe the event of being a particular normal form. And the same can happen if we look to add normal forms. The definition of add normal form for this calculus coincides with the definition for lambda calculus. It's just a sequence of abstraction, a head variable, followed by a sequence of arguments, and both the sequences can be empty. And in this case, the observation reaching a abnormal form is a good set of observation in the sense that it obeyed the definition before. And also we can observe the probability of reaching a particular normal, abnormal form, in this case, certainly closed by beta reduction. And from the definition, this property follow easily. Then given a sequence, then for each element of a set of observation, the sequence of distribution of probability of finding this element in the element of the sequence is not decreasing and bounded. And this means that this has a limit, which is the supremum of the sequence. And we call this limit distribution. So to each sequence, we can associate the limit distribution as the supremum of all the observation of the distribution with respect to a given observation. But if we start from M for a given multi-distribution, we can have different reduction sequences starting from N with different limit. So if we call certainly now, all I will discuss now will be modulo a set of observations, since we need first to define a set of observations, since the limit depend on the set of observation we chosen. And we call the limit of M with respect to the set of observation that we chosen, the set of limit distribution of all the sequences starting from M. And we have this theorem, which is the unicity of the asymptotic behavior of the computation of a term, saying that the limit distribution of a multi-distribution has a greatest element, which we indicate in this way, using this emphatic with this emphatic parenthesis. Notice that this is always a modulo a set of observations, so maybe it would be better to write obs sometimes, somewhere here. And this notion is adequate with respect to the reduction, in the sense that if M reduces to N, then the result of M is we can call this the result of the computation, the greatest element of the element. And the result of the computation M is the same as the result of the computation starting from N. So now we defined what is the result of a multi-distribution once we choose a particular set of observation. And now the problem is how to reach this result, how to make calculate the result, how to build a reduction sequence which you are sure to reach the result. And the natural answer is to define a standard reduction sequence. And we can define a finally standardization. First of all, we need to define what is a surface evaluation. I already defined what is a surface context, and a surface evaluation is the reduction between multiset closed under surface context. And it must be taken into account that the plus reduction is always closed under surface evaluation, under surface context. So now we close also the beta reduction also. And a reduction is deep if it is not surface, is inside the term. So we have this theorem stating a finally surface standardization, saying that if M reduces to N, these are two multi-distribution in a finite number of steps, then this evaluation can be decomposed by a sequence of surface evaluation followed by a sequence of deep evaluation. And the proof is always made using the tool for Lambda Calculus, since we need a sound and complete translation from Lambda Plus to Lambda Calculus, which now we need to ask this translation preserves the surface reduction. And we define on this a suitable notion of parallel reduction, which is exactly the tool used for proving standardization for Lambda Calculus. Now, in order to be more clear, let us restrict ourselves to the set of observations looking for head normal forms. We will see later why head normal form is a notion of result more important than normal forms, but this happens also in Lambda calculus. So here we have an asymptotic completeness or surface reduction, in the sense that if M has as limit a distribution mu, this happens if and only if M, the mu is a limit, a limit distribution, also of the reduction obtained from it, performing just the surface evaluation. So in order to reach the final distribution, we need to perform only the surface evaluation. But remember, this reduction is reflexive. So we can have also sequences in which nothing happens, in the sense that the multi-distribution is always the same from one step to the other. So in order to really use the reduction in order to compute the result, we define what is a S-full sequence, and which is any sequence of surface reductions starting from M, which at every step reduces all the term that can be reduced is possible. Certainly, if a term has not surface reduction, it remains the same. And the result is that the full sequence of surface reduction has, as a result, the result of M with respect to the set of observation H or H equivalent. So looking for the existence of an head normal form or looking for the existence of a particular head normal form. And so the surface sequences are complete for reaching the result. And an important corollary is that so the head strategy is complete. In fact, the head strategy is a restriction of the surface strategies. Surface strategy is a family of strategies, and the head strategy is one particular strategy of the family. And this corollary is important since it supplies a posteriori justification of the use of head strategy in probabilistic programming language. This choice has been made, for example, by Erard, Pagani, and Tasson in their probabilistic Lambda calculus. Now we proved that our calculus enjoys the important properties we ask to all calculi, confluence and standardization, and also an extension of both to the asymptotic behavior of terms. And now I will speak about another property, which is solvability. The solvability is a central semantic notion, at least for Lambda calculus, capturing the property of a term being meaningful. If we consider closed term, we can speak about programs. And in the Lambda calculus, the definition of solvability is the following: a Lambda term M is solvable if there is a surface context such that closing the M in this context better reduces to the identity. If we consider a closed term, a program, this means that a program can supply any result we want if we give it the correct sequence of arguments. And this is the intuitive notion of meaningful program into a calculus which has no context and which is higher order. And this is quite easy. Notice another thing, that the standard definition of solvability for lambda calculus does not use a surface context, but it uses an head context. But the two definitions are equivalent. Using surface or using head is the same. Here, I decided to present the property for lambda calculus for surface context in order to do the same in our probabilistic calculus. In fact, in our probabilistic calculus, what is the notion of solvability? So a first difficulty appears. It's not possible to speak about the property of being solvable for a term, but we need to speak about the properties of being solvable with a certain probability. And we define a term M to be solvable with probability at least P if there is a surface context S such that when filled by M, it reduces to a multidistribution such that the probability to finding the term I in this multidistribution is bigger or equal than P. And we can give also a more complete characterization saying a term is P solvable if P is the supremum of the Q such that M is at least a Q solvable. So we need to reason in two steps. One step, observe that in order to prove that M is solvable with probability at least P, we need to supply just one context, which is witness of this property. One context such that closing M in this context, the result reducing to a multidistribution with probability at least P. But maybe for proving that a term is P solvable, so a clear property, we need to supply more than one context, maybe an infinite amount of context, each one which is the witness that M is at least Q-solvable. So this property is really involved to be proved. For example, this term is one solvable, but in this case, the proof is easy since we can take this context, so supply M, which is a closed term by three arguments, in such a way that it reduces to the multidistribution in which the term I appear with probability, total probability one. And so the term is one solvable. In lambda calculus, solvability can be characterized at least in three different ways. Operationally, through the notion of head normal form, in the sense that a term is solvable if and only if it reduces to head normal form. Logically, through suitable type assignment systems based on intersection types, in the sense that we have some type assignment systems giving types to all and only the solvable terms. Or denotationally, through some denotational model that equate all the interpretation of terms which are unsolvable. And I will show that similar characterizations hold also for our calculus lambda class. In order to prove this, we need to extend the notion of normal forms to lambda class. We already defined what means in lambda class for a term being in head normal form. And this means exactly like in lambda calculus to have this shape. Lambda x1 xn, a variable in add position followed by m argument with n and m can be greater or equal to zero. But the involved property is what means to have add normal form. In the normal lambda calculus, to have add normal form means simply to be reduced to normal form, to add normal form. While here, we need to speak also about probabilities as usual. So a term M has add normal form with probability at least P, if there is a multidistribution such that the singleton of M reduces to this multidistribution M, and the probability of finding a add normal form in this M is at least P. And then we can go to the supremum, defining what means for a term having add normal form with a given probability P. And in this case, we take the supremum of all the Q such that M has add normal form with probability Q. For example, we can have, we can choose omega is the cycling term, just for putting something strange in my example, and having a term like this in which one of the argument of this subterm is omega, and this has 1/2 add normal form, at least 1/2 add normal form, and also add normal form with probability one, since it reduces to this multidistribution in which both the components are normal forms. Here is the example of a term which has, which is the identity plus omega. Clearly omega has no normal form being a cycling term. And in this case, this I plus omega reduces to a multidistribution in which I appear only with probability 1/2. So this term is at least 1/2, has at least 1/2 add normal form. We will give a characterization of the solvable term using in Lambda Plus, using as a tool a type assignment system based on non-idempotent intersection types. And these are types which are a bit involved in the sense that a type is a multidistribution of simple types. This means that a multiset, I used a different parenthesis here to not have too much occurrences of square parentheses in this case, not to be too confused by the notation. So is a multiset of simple types, each one occurring with a given probability. Is a multidistribution. This means that the sum of the probability is less or equal than one. This condition is always a condition holding in all multidistributions. A simple type is either a constant or a narrow type, having on the right side a type, on the left side a context type, when a context type is just a multiset of types, a multiset of elements of this kind. So a multiset of multidistribution. And we can define type context as partial functions from variables to context types with finite domain. And this is the type assignment system. The type assignment system assigns types to terms starting from a type context. And it can also assign a multiset, and we will speak about this after. I think some comments are needed here in order to understand how the system works. The first is about variables. So if we have a type context assigned to a variable X, a multiset, we can derive for X an element of this multiset. So this rule says that the weakening is derivable in our system. And this is an important tool we need for having a subject reduction property. So the rules for arrow introduction and arrow elimination works on by modifying the component of a type. This means a term inside the multidistribution, which is a type. For example, M, look at this, an arrow introduction. If to M has been assigned a multidistribution of this kind, where AI is appear with probability PI, starting from a premise for X, which is a multiset, big A, then to the abstraction lambda XM, we can assign a multiset in which every element has been obtained to an element of the multidistribution before by inserting an arrow with left argument the premise on X and preserving the probability. So the arrow is built at the interior of the element of a multidistribution, as the same happens in the arrow elimination rules, since M can be used as a function and can be applied to N if all the elements in the type assigned to M are arrow types. And to M, we need to assign all the elements on the right, on the left part of the arrow. And in order to assign to a term a multiset and not only a type, we have this rule bang, simply collecting a certain number, maybe zero, of types into a multiset. So if in order to assign to M also a multiset. Notice that this rule is useful but not necessary, since we could write the arrow elimination rule without the bang rule, but this would be really involved. Now the syntax of the system is easier in this way, but this is not necessary but useful. And the rules for the plus are as we expect. We can type the plus constructor M plus N, a plus term, typing either both the argument, both the element, and putting the union of the multiset of the multidistribution, each one with probability 1/2. Or we can type just one of the element and assigning to the term this type with probability 1/2. Another observation, important observation, is that while the arrow elimination is given in multiplicative style, the plus of, rule is given in additive style. And this is important, this is essential, this additive presentation of the plus rule is essential in order to obtain the subject reduction property. The system can give type also to term in which not all subterms are typed, but through the rule plus, here we have the identity plus big omega, and the multidistribution contains just the type for the identity with probability 1/2, while here through the arrow elimination rule, in which on the left side of the arrow, an empty multiset has been, is present. And so we can assign a type to lambda x, x omega without assigning any type to omega. And the system has the good properties of subject reduction and subject expansion. Also, these properties are not really equal to the corresponding property expertise for system for lambda calculus, since the subject reduction says that if there is a proof assigning to M a type A for a type contest gamma, and M reduces to a multiset, to a multi-distribution in which making in this way, then this means that the type for M can be decomposed in multi-distribution of types such that to some of the element of M, a multi-distribution of this is assigned. So not all the terms to which M reduces are typed, but maybe a subset of them. And the subject expansion is similar in the other direction. So using this system, we succeed in giving a final characterization of solvability in the sense that we prove that the three following statements are equivalent. Either M is at least P solvable, if and only if M has at least P ad normal form with probability P, and also M can be assigned a term which is a multi-distribution where the sum of probability is exactly P. So in order to look at the property to be P solvable with at least probability P, we need one assignment with this probability. While a total characterization of P solvability is similar, just we can take the supremum, but now we need to look at all the possible derivation for M in order to look at the maximum associated probability. This type of tangent system induces a relational model for lambda plus, such that the interpretation of closed terms is the set of typing of this term, gamma A, where gamma is a type context and A is a type. Certainly you can define also the interpretation of open terms, but this is much more involved. And this interpretation is adequate with respect to the reduction, in the sense that if M reduces to a multi-distribution, this implies that the interpretation of M is the union of the interpretation of the terms in multi-distribution, each of these with the pound of the corresponding probability. And the characterization of p-solvability is, as we expect, M is p-solvable if P is the supremum of the probabilities in the interpretation of M. Speaking in the lambda calculus dialect, this model is sensible in the sense that all the unsolvable terms are denotationally equal. Here, speaking about denotational unsolvable terms means to speak about the zero solvable terms, terms having ad normal form, being solvable with probability zero. And this applies on a posteriori justification of our definition of p-solvability, since if we can equate all terms not having this property in a denotational model, this means that the property has a denotational important meaning. So a conclusion, sorry, maybe I'm a bit late. The language lambda plus I presented is a conservative extension of lambda calculus, is complete for probabilistic computation. This has been proved separately by Dallago and Zorzi. It enjoys confluence and standardization extended to asymptotic computations, and a notion of solvability can be defined in it, supported by a denotational model. So I think that lambda plus can be reasonably proposed as a foundational calculus for probabilistic computation. Thank you for your attention. And sorry for the problem of the screen.
Thank you very much, Simona, for a very beautiful talk and about some very elegant body of work. Let's thank Simona for a beautiful talk, and then perhaps we can have some questions.
Okay, thanks.
when the modern world, it's difficult to hear everyone else, but I assume everyone was applauding. So if we can have a few minutes for questions, that would be a pleasure. I'm sure that she has stimulated many many thoughts in many of you. I think the method is you're meant to use the Q&A, and I will monitor that and relay the questions, or I think Simona can also see them.
No questions.
Well, I myself will jump in then, because one of the characteristics of your work that's been very influential and impressive to me is that invariably these elegant mathematical seeming results have application to practical programming. And that's been proved over and over and over again in the course of your career. And at the end, you tease us a little bit. So I wonder whether you or your co-authors have actually given any thought to developing these ideas for a programming language, particularly in light of the popularity of probabilistic programming these days and practically every aspect of our lives on computers. I wonder if you had any thoughts about that.
But I think in order to have a programming language, maybe to have a call by value version of Lambda Plus, is more useful. And we designed a call by value version. We designed a call by value version, which we presented in the leaks of the last year, leaks 19. And but in the call by value version, we proved both the property of confluence and the standardization, not yet the problem of solvability, since solvability has a very different status in call by name and call by value. So there are two different problems to deal with. And I think the call by value version can be more adapted for build a programming language. I'm not an applicative person, so I can just do something theoretical. I'm sorry.
Sure.
So my job is this one.
Understood. I'm sure that one of us will pick up these ideas and carry them forward. Are there any other questions? Ah, here we go. Simona, can you see that question or should I read it out?
No, I don't see the question.
Okay, it says a small question. Is this talk based on several publications, and is there a foundational and calculus for probabilistic computation paper out there? And the person mentions having seen some other papers related to your work. Perhaps you have a bibliography handy or?
But all these results are just in two papers. The first one is the paper presented at LEAKS last year by myself and Claudia Fajang. And the other one with solvability, we studied solvability in a different paper. And the solvability is in the paper we presented here with Ugo Dallago and Claudia Fajang here at the FSCD, so is in the proceedings. And while in the LEAKS, we presented both the call by value and the call by name version. These are just two papers in which all these results are collected.
Okay, and we have another question from Sylvia Gillison saying, thank you for your elegant talk, I would concur. And my question is about possibly non-idempotent and idempotent types, and can the work consider these? I'm relaying that. I'm not positive I did it properly.
I think we could work also with idempotent types without any problems. We choose the non-idempotent since in this way the properties are much more easier to be proved. We does not need to use reducibly candidate or things like that in order to prove subject reduction and the interpretation of term and so on. So we choose non-idempotencies just for having a system in which it is easier to make proofs. But an idempotent version can be built. Certainly, idempotent version means to consider, in some sense, to revise a bit the language, in some sense that it depends for the meaning of idempotent and not idempotent. Mm. Since we can replace, for example, the context types, the multiset with set, and nothing change. The type in the context to have a system with idempotent types, but we could also replace a multi-distribution in the types with distribution. And this will change a bit, since it does no more correspond to the language, since in the calculus we have multi-distribution of terms. And so it's much more natural to have also here multi-distribution. So replacing multiset by set in the context means to have idempotent intersection, and this is okay, does not change anymore, in order to be more precise.
Good, the questioner seems to approve of that answer. So good. Are there any further questions for Simona before we close? I'll give people a moment. Okay, good. Then let's finish. Let us please thank Simona once again. Thank you for a very beautiful talk. I appreciated it very much. Very characteristic in style. It was a pleasure. Thank you very much, Simona, and good to see you.